In this video, we're going to go over compositing this shot inside of After Effects. If you check the description, you'll find a link where you can download the 3D render as well as the background footage so you could follow along. Let's get to it.
So I'm going to start by dragging our footage into a new comp, and I'm just going to change this to 8-bit while we work for now, just so that everything moves quicker. So here we have our footage pre-comped, and you'll notice at the end of the timeline I have a marker, and that's because I'm referencing that frame when I built this in Blender. That's the frame that we want to match everything up onto, including the tracking and everything. So I'll take our render here of the Metroids, and you can see it's not really tracked onto the shot. So the first thing we want to do is actually track our footage. So let's create a null object, which is going to hold the tracking data. So we'll just rename it tracking data, and we're going to track our footage. So we'll double click, right click, track motion. And it's kind of hard to see because it's very small because we're in 4K, but let's just move this down and we'll put this here. That seems like a high contrast area. And then we could do rotation and scale, and we'll move this over to this side. So I'll put it right there. I think that's a good spot. And I'll just make this slightly bigger, and same thing for this. This is the search area. So it's going to search whatever's in here, and if the camera moves too much and it's outside of this outer box, then it's going to lose the track. So make sure that's big enough to cover the camera movement. And we'll just track backwards here. So it happens pretty quick. One note about motion tracking camera movement. If you're just doing a pan or tilt shot, then you don't need a 3D camera track. You can actually just get away with a standard motion tracker in After Effects. So that's just one thing to keep note of, so that when you're on set, maybe you can make it a little easier on yourself and just do a pan or tilt shot rather than a handheld walking shot. Keep it simple and it'll be simpler in post. So we have this track and it looks pretty good. So I'm just going to edit the target here. Make sure it's on tracking data. Hit OK. We don't have it applied yet. We have to apply it. So we'll hit apply. X and Y, yes, okay. And now we have our tracking data attached to the null object. So again, we worked off of this last frame. Remember that marker is there. So we want to go to that last frame and then parent the Metroid Swarm footage to the tracking data on that last frame. So there we go. That's looking good. And you'll notice here that if we go back to the beginning, we have a gap in the footage because the footage isn't big enough. So that's one thing that you want to keep in mind, is that maybe design it a little bit larger. So instead of like 1920 by 1080 or 3840 by 2160, you might just keep that aspect ratio, but just design it a little bit bigger so that you don't have to do what I'm about to do here. But that's fine. We can deal with this. What we can do here is actually take, let me change the color of this layer so we can actually see what we're doing here. So purple. And I'll press Y on the keyboard and we'll activate the pan behind tool. We'll take the anchor point of the Metroid Swarm footage and we'll just move it down to the edge of this building, because that's where we want the Metroids to disappear behind. So we'll keep it there. And then when we scale this up so that the border gets bigger, we're scaling from this point so we don't lose the point in which the Metroids go behind the building. So right there is pretty good. Now you have to be careful because the left side, if you can see here, the left side is still cut off. So you have to be careful that if any Metroids come in, like right there, you can see that that's cut off. I guess we could probably just scale it up even more, or we can move it over to the right. The only thing is that we lose the Metroids going on the edge of the building, but that's up to you. I'll leave that up to you guys. I'm actually going to scale it up even more. So we should be good around there. And remember, it's only for a couple of frames too. So yeah, so we're good there. Yeah, that's perfect. So we don't have any Metroids getting clipped or cut off on the edge there. But that's kind of cool because you can change the position of where the Metroids are, but still have it track to the camera. So the next thing we have to do is put the Metroids behind the building. We're going to come back and deal with the sharpness of the Metroids later. It is a bit sharp and CG looking, so we're going to help that blend a little bit better. We're going to roto the building first. So let's duplicate the building footage and we'll drop this on top of the Metroids, and we'll just lower the opacity a little bit so we can kind of see what's going on, and we'll name this Roto Building. Another thing I want to do is create a solid, and we're going to use this solid as the Roto mat. So we're going to Roto on the solid and then use that as a alpha mat for this Roto building layer. The benefit of this is that we can actually link this solid to the track so that we can minimize the amount of keyframing that we have to do to the mask. So you'll see in a second what I mean, but we'll just name this Roto mat. And a trick that we want to do is we want to make sure that it's bigger than the comp. So right now it's 8,000 by 4,500, and that keeps our 16:9 aspect ratio. So I want to make this bigger because when it's attached to the track, make sure, again, we're on this marker here. And so we'll attach this to the tracking data. If this solid was too small, then it would move out of frame there. So let's say, for instance, it was the size of the comp. Now with the tracking, you can see that it's not big enough. So you want to make sure that you make the solid big enough so that it doesn't clip on the edges there. Okay, so I'm going to turn the Roto building opacity up all the way, and I'm going to turn the opacity down. Or another thing I could do actually is just shut it off. So just shut it off so we can see the footage underneath it and we can Roto around the building. Now make sure the Roto mat solid is selected, and we'll create a mask and we'll come in here and start Rotoing. So one thing to keep in mind here is that you probably don't need to go all crazy over here, because this is not where the Metroids are going behind the building. So I'm just going to include this part and we should be good. We don't need to do any other detailed Roto here. None of the Metroids pass this section here. So you don't need to do any detailed Roto here. The more detailed Roto you have to do is over here, where they are going behind the building. I know, since this is my film and I'm the director, that I want the Metroids right here, so I'm not gonna move it. So there's no point in Rotoing that part of the building. I'm just gonna go to the end here and I'm gonna take a look at the mask and see if it falls off at all here. Let's follow this along. Now I can already see that it's falling off, so let's just create a keyframe at the end. And a good way to do this is not to go to the end and then move one frame and then Roto, and then move another frame and Roto. We want to work with the interpolation that's built into After Effects. The best way to do that is actually to create a key here, fix the mask, and then go in the middle of the two, and then create another key, and then fix the mask there. I'm just going to fix this here. So we're falling off a bit over here, and let's just select these 2 points, and now we can use the number pad to kind of move that in. So that's good. Now that we've done this for the first frame and then the last frame, what we want to do is go in the middle of the two. So roughly in the middle, somewhere around here, and see if the mask has fallen off at all here. And I'm seeing it's barely fallen off. So that's a good thing. We have less cleanup to do here. So I think we are pretty good. Move that over, and then now we want to go in the middle of these two keyframes and make sure the mask didn't fall off. So pretty good, but I think we can do a little bit better here. All right, so then you want to go in the middle of these two keyframes. That looks good, so we don't have to worry about it. Go in the middle of these two keyframes. That looks good. So now we want to go in the middle of these two keyframes. And so this is the most efficient way to Roto, because you're interpolating between these two. And what's going to happen is that when you fix and create a keyframe over here where the playhead is, then it's going to interpolate now between this new section. So let's go ahead and do that. So select that. And then we want to go in between these two, and that looks good. So we don't need to add any more keyframes. So we have a total of what, four or five keyframes for our Roto job. And that didn't really take all that long, so that's good. You can see how much the tracking data actually helped us here. Kind of did most of the work for us. So now I'm just going to turn this back on, make sure the opacity is up all the way. And then we can use this solid as a mat. So we'll take this, click this button to show the track mat, and then we'll just select our Roto mat. And we can see here that the Metroids are going behind the building, and that's looking good. We do want to feather the edge a little bit, so we'll go back to the Roto mat, bring up our mask by hitting MM on the keyboard, So M twice, and we'll do 1.5 pixels. This might be too much. What I'm seeing is that we're getting a little bit of the blue from the sky. So we're gonna erode the mask a little bit. So instead of expanding it, we're gonna shrink it down. So we'll do -1, and that should get rid of that. That's looking pretty good. So I'm happy with that.
Hey guys, sorry to interrupt this video. I just want to remind you to like and subscribe so you don't miss out on future videos, including future filmmaking and visual effects tutorials. All right, let's jump back into it.
Looking good. Now, one thing I want to do is fix the look of the Metroids. They're a bit sharp if you compare them to the rest of the footage, as you can see here. So what I'm going to do is I'll zoom in a little bit and we'll add a blur. So we'll go to blur, camera lens blur. And the default is way too high. And I think even 1 is too high. So we might even just have to go all the way down to like 0.1. And we'll turn this on and off to see what that does. Okay, it's slight softening. Maybe we'll do 0.2. I think that's a little bit better. But you know what we can do? We're gonna add more motion blur to this. So we'll do 0.1. Or actually, let's split the difference, 0.15. That's looking good. Now, one thing I didn't do when I rendered the Metroids, as you can see here, there's no motion blur. We'll do pixel, if I can spell it right, pixel motion blur. And what this is going to do is add motion blur to our footage. So you can see here that where there's a lot of movement, it's going to add that to the shot. This is very heavy on the CPU, so just set it and then turn it off until you're ready to render. So here we'll do 180 for the shutter angle. Samples, I like to bring it up to at least 16, and I'll show you what the difference is. But you can see here that that motion blur looks nice and smooth. Now, if I go back to what it was, you can see there's sort of like this echoing effect. And that's because you don't have enough samples. That's 5 samples. So if we switch it to 16 samples, at least that kind of clears that up. Sometimes you might need to switch it to 24, but just remember the higher that number, the slower it is gonna be to process. And you can see that the gain that you get there is very minimal. So I think 16 is a pretty good compromise there. And also, if you want, you can just switch it to 24, turn it off while you work, and then turn that back on when you render. But I'm just gonna keep it at 16 and I'll shut that off for now. So this is pretty much set to go. We do maybe want to match our black levels a little bit here. So let's bring up the Lumetri scopes and I'll just dock it here next to our window here. So I'll add a curves effect. You can see that if I do this, it actually blends a little bit better. One trick that you can use here is that as I move the blacks on the curve, you can kind of see where the rest of the shot is and where the Metroids are. Right, so this section here is the Metroids, but the rest of our footage is resting somewhere around here. So we want to match that just so that it integrates a little bit better. So maybe something around there, or maybe a little bit lower, maybe somewhere around there. Got to play around with it, but maybe somewhere around there. Now, it's very subtle, but I think it does a better job of matching the Metroids into the shot. So that's looking pretty good. And maybe I want to give it just a little bit more darkness there. So maybe somewhere around there. Very subtle thing. That's a little trick. Use your scopes to match the black levels. And also you can actually turn off the color channels and just, you know, view the blue channel. So now you can really compare the two and see where you're at. So you can see here that like this area is pretty dark compared to the rest. So what we can do actually is maybe just lift it up slightly. But I did, again, this is like a by the numbers thing. So what you want to do is do it by the numbers and then do it by eye. So switch this color back on here. I think we're good. I might want to darken that just a little bit, but instead of doing the black level, I might just overall just bring the midtones down a little bit just to make them a little more menacing. Now, they are slightly more saturated than everything else, so I want to come in and we'll bring in the hue and saturation and maybe just knock it down like -5 or -10. Let's see what -10 looks like. That's pretty good. The last step I want to do is actually add an adjustment layer on top, and we'll name this film look. So film look CC for color correction, and we'll add film convert. And what this is going to do is add grain and halation on top of everything. Now, it's up to you if you want to keep the curve and the chroma adjustments that happen. I'm going to go with Super 35. I'll keep the halation. Now, one thing that I love about film convert is it has this softness built in. So I usually like to just add a bit of softness on my footage overall. I just feel like it makes it look a little bit more cinematic. Now, that's debatable. You don't have to do that, but I like the way that looks. So I'm just going to add a little bit of softness. So we'll do about 20. And I think that does a good job of blending everything together. I actually might bring in the chroma and luma and then just bring up the saturation here, because I actually do like what it's doing. I like that green in the Metroids there. And I also like the colors on the building. I like what it's doing to the colors on the building, so I'm going to keep that. So what I'll do is instead, I'll just bring up the saturation to about 135. And that's looking good. We got the blue in the sky back. Now, one thing I'm noticing here is that our Roto matte layer is actually below the film color correction. So if I turn that on, you can see that it's actually affecting the matte. So take your Roto matte layer and put it above the color correction layer. And you can see that now it doesn't affect the matte. So we'll turn this back off. And the last step is to turn our camera lens blur back on and also the pixel motion. So now we can add that motion blur back into the shot. And that kind of just implies movement and motion. And it's going to take a little while to render, but I think it's worth it. And I think it looks a hell of a lot better with all that. As you can see, it's like you can see these kind of coming in quick. This guy is probably in like a slower bit of motion. I'm actually going to render this out and we'll see what this looks like. So this is the final render and it looks pretty cool. The motion blur, the grain halation, and everything that we added on top really sells the effect. And I really love the pixel motion blur, the effect that it has on the swarm of Metroids coming in from the upper left corner. It really gives it that sense of motion and flow. So if you like this video, please like and subscribe. My name is Paul Dovecchio, and I'll catch you guys next time.